Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. The title might surprise you that Ramadan actually can turn against you. And yes, it can actually, and maybe it has, or probably it has been against you for years. You just did not realize that. Can Ramadan actually bring you ruin? Yes, it can. Physically, you have fasted Ramadan, but emotionally, intellectually, and at belief-wise level, how is that working for you? In this very short pep talk, I am going, inshallah, to give you one trick on how not to feel bad internally about what you have achieved in Ramadan. Ramadan, every year when it comes to us, is always, always, always overhyped. And I say overhyped, because Muslims believe the more we hype up Ramadan, the more we pump up people, the more they're gonna do good, the more they're gonna benefit from Ramadan, and blah, blah. And this in itself is a huge error. This is because, for example, I'm gonna take an example so that to illustrate my point. In classrooms or in major exams, there is always a pre-exam to the main exam. For example, if you are in France, you will take the baccalaureate and there is the white one or maybe the pre-bac and then the after one when you take the real example. Now, the one is that it's a mock-up test so that you get the feel and the hang on how the real test will look like. Now, a lot of we Muslims, what we do is we prepare greatly for the pre-exam and then we fail in the exam. And here is how it goes. Ramadan is not for what it is itself. It is what comes after Ramadan. Ramadan, put it this way, should have probably, in my opinion, been the first month of the year. Because what happens in Ramadan is people do get back to Allah. People start reading the Quran. And strangely enough, I take the underground train here in London every single day. I've never seen anyone reading the Quran until Ramadan came, and suddenly I saw three people or four people reading the Quran on the underground, and that triggered something in me. What makes these people not read the Quran in normal days? Now, you might say that maybe they have, but these people are almost regulars as I on that train. But comes Ramadan, people change, people behaviors change. Why is that? Because at subconscious level, the value of Ramadan is only in the 30 days. We have never ever made people believe that Ramadan is the beginning of the year in your actions. Perhaps when it comes to counting, administration and everything, the first year is Muharram, as Umar ibn al-Khattab, the Sahaba, did it before. But when it comes to emotional journeys, Ramadan should have been the first month for our emotional calendar, our belief calendar. What we do in Ramadan is what's going to set the tone for the rest of the year. Our problem is we hype up Ramadan with weak hadiths, with the scholars. Like I hear this, when Ramadan came, a Shafi'i would terminate the recitation of Al-Quran 60 times. That is twice a day. And people go, wow, a Shafi'i does that? Yes, Abu Hanifa for 40 years, he prayed Salat Fajr with Isha wudu. And you go, oh, what a great man. All this is nonsense, absolutely nonsense. It just makes you feel small. A Shafi'i read it 60 times. Guess what? A shaitan does not get, nor the shayateen get chained in Ramadan. That is a big lie. If a shaitan is chained in hellfire, if the doors or the gates of hellfire are closed, as they say, as they claim, I don't believe that. If the gates of Jannah are open in Ramadan, so what it is, what we have done, what have we done to accumulate these great rewards? Allah locks up the shaitan so that we enter Jannah? This is nonsense. This goes against the core of Al-Quran, that a shaitan is our sworn, pure sworn enemy. It does not get chained anytime soon. Anyhow, the only time he's going to get chained is when he enters hellfire on Judgment Day. But the way these ignorant people who do not read the consequences to what they do, What happens is they hype up Ramadan to make it, oh, Ramadan is coming, and you start getting these WhatsApp messages. If you send this on that thing, you're going to get this fake reward, which they claim, and it's a lie. And then you get the sheikhs in the masjid, you Jumu'ah in the masjid, the television channels. Suddenly you have an increase in Islamic materials, all these things, and the television uses you to take your money away. The charity organizations also do that. Everybody hypes up Ramadan, and you come, you. Now, I'm going to talk to you. Before Ramadan, at emotional level, maybe you have not put it down on paper, even though I have given you a list of things that you can achieve in Ramadan, and I was not joking, because once you write something down, you are 95% away from achieving your goal. But if you don't write it, you are 100% away from achieving that goal, and you will never achieve it. Now, at the beginning of Ramadan, at emotional level, and this is where the danger comes in, at emotional subconscious level, you set yourself a platform that I want to get there. And then at the end of Ramadan, I'm not going to go to the end, but at the beginning, probably 2-3 days in Ramadan, you have not accomplished that. What happens then? A shaitan knows that you have this strange fake belief that he is chained in hellfire. So all your guards are down, so he can work freely on you. So shaitan comes to you on day one and day two, and he goes, ah, you know what? You actually didn't get this Ramadan started on the right foot. You know what? Just make do with it. And next year, inshallah, you will do much better. You will learn from this Ramadan, and next year you do better. And guess what? And then you drop the towel like in a boxing ring, and you dingle around, you twingle around, and mingle around until the end of Ramadan with that heavy feeling in your heart. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm sure you are feeling it right now, because you feel you have not accomplished what you intended and you set your journey to accomplish. And guess what? Next year comes in, shaitan knows the trick has worked on you last year, and he will do exactly the same thing year on, year on, year on, and you lose faith in yourself. Your imanic Islamic self-esteem is absolutely dangling on the ground. You feel worthless. You feel, even though you are praying, even though you are doing everything that you wanted to do, but in the sight of Allah, you are a piece of nothing. You are not even proud of anything that you've done in Islam. Am I wrong? Now, if I am wrong, say Abu Hanifa or Abdus Salam, you're wrong. But if I am correct, say I am correct, and you need to change that. When Allah made the angels make sujood to our Father, the prostrate to our Father, he didn't make them just because of our eyes, and he didn't make them do that because of our... He made them for us. And what makes us different than them? The mind, the intellect, that the Salafi world has put in the refrigerator is not to be used. In that mind, there is a portion of you called the subconscious. That subconscious, my dear sisters and my brothers, is like the black box on a plane. It records everything, and it is that subconscious of yours, when you go to sleep at night, that files up what is important and what is not important to you. It categorizes everything and it indexes them, so that when you need them, it brings them to you. Let me give you an example. You don't have a car and you are happy with your life, and then suddenly one day you want to buy a car. Just you had a thought and you start materializing that thought and thinking about it, the subconscious looks at you and goes, uh-huh, they want to buy a car. Now, without you realizing it, you'll be walking down the street and you'll start looking at cars. And then the subconscious here does not have much to work with, so it just presents you with cars. And then suddenly you saw a car and you go, oh, I like that red color. Now the brain, your subconscious, has got an extra element to work with. It knows you like red cars. So guess what? From now on, what your subconscious will do, it will just present you with red cars. And suddenly you start noticing a lot of red cars in the street. And you go, uh-huh, Allah wants me to buy... Allah wants me to buy a red car. That's why he makes me see all these red cars. Then the brain here, your subconscious, knows that it's leveled the thing a little bit down to the color. Then one day you'll be walking by and you see this Audi car and you go, oh, I like that Audi. And the moment you start thinking about it, the subconscious will pay a special attention on the highway or the road, wherever you are, looking for a red Audi, just like you described. And lo and behold, your eyes start looking and finding that there are actually lots of red Audis. And then you go, this is a sign from Allah that he wants, I can buy a red Audi. Not only that, your subconscious now has got the grip over you. A car, red Audi. And at night when you go to sleep, when it files and indexes all those things, it starts displaying those pictures in something called your dreams. Your dreams are only a vessel that carries the message of your subconscious. And at night you start seeing red cars. And you go, when you wake up in the morning, I saw that in a dream. It is again a sign from Allah. Then comes what? And then you go, you do your shopping list, and you buy yourself a red car, and you start, and when you speak to your people, you go, you know what? This car, I've got a special relationship, and then you link it to Islam, and it is Allah. When in fact, it is all your subconscious that has designed all this. Back to Ramadan. When Ramadan starts to come, or about to come, and they hype up Ramadan, you boost yourself and you start suddenly having a different perception about the hereafter. Oh, Ramadan is here, this is gonna happen, this is gonna happen, this, but you have not documented anything. So the brain is working with something that it cannot quantize. How it does that work? Have you been to Hawaii? You haven't, right? But if I start seeing the ocean and there is the mountains and just at the leeway alley, there is this huge, beautiful ocean. And the forest, the rainforest, and the combination of the oceans, it gives lots of rainbows. And the rainbows is what is Hawaii known for. It's called the state of the rainbows. When you go there to the sea, the water is warm. Have you seen how your brain now just can follow? Even though I told you it's a trick, I'm gonna play a trick on you, but your brain follows and you start imagining Hawaii. But the dangerous thing is you've given a picture of Hawaii in your own mind, based on what I said. So now in your mind, if you go back to that picture, you will have a picture. If we were all artists and we were all in a different classrooms and I gave you all a canvas and a few things to paint, we won't paint the same picture because our brain interprets reality differently. It gives different colors and everything based on our personal choices. So when Ramadan comes in and they start the taqwa, Abu Hanifa, al-Shafi'i, the Sahaba, Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was like the wind and he would do this. But we forget all the elements. These are humans. What it is that they did extra in Ramadan that made them extra. Do you know what they did extra? Nothing. They just fasted extra. Their lifestyle was the same as before. Don't think that the Sahaba were lazy people. And when Ramadan came, they suddenly started reciting the Quran much. This is a huge, big lie. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when you look at his life, he used to stand every night in Salat, and so did the Sahaba. They used to perform Qiyam, they used to do everything, the Dhikr Salat on time, not lie, not cheat, everything they did on every day. When Ramadan came, they only added a little bit more. But when Ramadan went, let me put it like this. Before Ramadan, their taqwa level was 75% out of 100. That's throughout the year. When Ramadan came, they were 80-85%. They didn't go over 100, they were just like 10% more. When Ramadan left, they were always 80-82-77. They were still in the average of what they were before. When Ramadan came, Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to receive Jibreel every night and they used to study Al-Quran. He didn't add anything extra to his Qiyamul Layl or Tahajjud, or what they call today Taraweeh. Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam stayed the same. He didn't change much. He just studied Ramadan Quran more. That's all there is to it. And the study was so that later on our mother Aisha described him like he was a moving Quran. So the lie, the biggest lie that has been hyped up about Ramadan is kind of like it's a magical potion. It's a magical formula. If you do these, that's it. Your life is going to change. But we Muslims are, as I said before, we are very primitive. Our mind is so childlike. We can't study our past to design our future. Even though this experience has not worked for years, how many Ramadans have you fasted? How many? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10, 15? You still are the same. You've always been the same. Have you ever asked yourself, why am I always like this? When before Ramadan comes in, I get hyped up. When Ramadan comes out, I feel bummed down and that's it. No more to it. Well, guess this year, my dear sisters and my brothers, I want you to change that. And I want you to believe that what you did in Ramadan, it is who you are and who you truly are. And then take the next 11 years to build on what you show yourself worth in Ramadan. In Ramadan, when Ramadan came, it only showed you your true market value. So when you didn't lie, that's who you are. Don't when Ramadan leave, you go back to your lying. Just stay where you are and gradually build so that next year, for example, yeah, this year you didn't lie in Ramadan, the whole month you didn't lie. And when I say lying, it means when you park in a place and they give you a ticket and then you go and challenge that ticket and you lie when you do it. I'm not saying just, you lie in different ways. So because you didn't do it in this Ramadan, then guess what? Start with that. Let's make Ramadan is your zero term. And gradually, every month, build 1%. By next Ramadan, you would have been, alhamdulillah, 11 or 12% higher in the truth department. Comes that Ramadan, then you work with the 12%, and then the Ramadan after, gradually, and you start building the process. Those who watch pornography, and this usually is widely spread between men rather than women, or those who smoke weed. The same thing. When Ramadan came, you did not watch pornography. That's not pious. That's you being normal. And then when Ramadan goes out, don't go back at the abnormal. Stay normal and build on that. Get away and slowly, by next Ramadan, you'll be 12% away from pornography than what you were last year. And then on that, you build. You take a new habit the next year and you build on it until when you are old enough, you would have accumulated a lot of things at 80%, 90%. And that is actually achievable and beautiful. The reason you feel low and down, your example is just like that fat person. And I mean fat, not big and all these deceptive terms. I mean a fat, unhealthy person who sets themselves on a goal to lose weight. And that's why they call it yo-yo dieting. And always they start on a Monday. They build up and hype up themselves and everything. I'm going to lose weight, blah, blah, blah. And guess what? They go Monday, Tuesday, and then they mess up on Wednesday. They go, oh, I've messed up on Wednesday. Since I've messed up on Wednesday, let me mess up Thursday, and then Juma, Friday, and then Saturday and Sunday, and I will start next Monday. And they start next Monday, and you know the cycle, and they get fatter and fatter and fatter and fatter. And then when you tell them, why don't you lose weight? They will tell you, I've tried everything, and I couldn't lose weight this way. It's genetic, and they start rationalizing and thinking differently. Okay, this is exactly the same thing that happens to you in Ramadan. Every year comes Ramadan, you're going to say, I'm going to shake some sins. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. Couple days in Ramadan, you've accomplished nothing. Then you wasted the next 28 days and you start counting down the days. When is this Ramadan going to leave? And then when it leaves, next year. And you've been fasting for the last 20 years, 10 years, 5 years, whatever number of years, and you still are the same. Something needs to be done. So this year, do this one trick here. One trick that is going to make the best out of you. And say to yourself, take a piece of paper. Don't just take it in your mind. Your subconscious is very tricky. It's very mischievous in playing tricks on you. So what you gotta do is take a piece of paper and write down what you liked about yourself. Don't write down what you didn't like. Ignore that. Just write down what you liked about yourself. Make a list. 10, 12, 4, 5, 1, even if it is one thing. One thing being, I woke up for Fajr every day, even though what woke you up really is Suhoor, but that doesn't matter. Is the truth of the matter is you woke up. So you say, I woke up, I didn't miss one single Fajr prayer in Ramadan. And then write a few lines about it, how it made you feel. At subconscious level, okay, and how it is going to impact your life, and then take that, you waking up for Ramadan every single Fajr, as the zero, the starting point, not like the big achievement. That's who you truly are. and then start building. And every time you miss Salat al-Fajr, go back to your Ramadan. Read what you have written, because it becomes an anchor for you to move on forward. So for this Ramadan, write down what you liked about yourself, not the failures, don't worry about that. Write down what you liked about yourself and build on that. And I pray to Allah that this Ramadan will not bring you ruin as the previous Ramadans have. And next year, don't listen to too much hype. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Ramadan is a month of guidance and taqwa. And taqwa is the opposite of transgression, and guidance is the opposite of misguidance. Alhamdulillah, you stayed in Ramadan, you fasted, you did your best. That's your guidance. Now, do not transgress about yourself by lowering your wealth self. How much you are worth, for example, if you are worth 20 billion, don't sell yourself short for £1, because that is really, really a losing deal. I pray to Allah to help us all in this getting better journey towards Him. And no more hyping up of Ramadan. Ramadan, Allah mentioned it once, Ramadan, and that's that. He didn't hype it up at all. Okay? I pray to Allah that this will be of help to you. If you need any more help about this or some coaching about getting out of your issues or your failures, I'll be more than happy to help you do just that. Again, this is your brother Abdul Salam Abu Hanifa. My telephone number is 44, the international code, 78764087 35. I pray to Allah to see you on the other side of the world in the hereafter in the best of manners and ways. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.